right, everyone, welcome to another edition of SVG Sports Tech On Demand, and we got a good one for you right here. Two leading execs from one of the big names in media right now, Scott Beckett, AT&T Director of the product management team, and Pete Scott, Warner Media VP of Emerging Media and Innovation. Look, when the AT&T deal went down and Warner Media came out of that, I think a lot of people saw the potential synergies when it comes to the technology, the infrastructure, the power behind AT&T, and the content creation abilities, the innovation abilities of what is now Warner Media. And that's what we're going to talk about a little today with Scott and Pete. First of all, guys, welcome. Thanks so much for taking the time. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So, Pete, I'm going to start with you and Scott, mm-hmm. Then we'll check in with you. But, you know, right now, in general, what do you see as the biggest challenge that's facing the industry? And, you know, how are you guys trying to confront that challenge, especially in the face of what's happened over the last year plus?
Yeah, I mean, I think, thanks a lot, Jason, for inviting us. We're excited to talk to you guys. You know, my biggest thing is, how do we keep people more engaged in content, live content? You know, you're seeing numbers across the board in sports where, people are watching less of sports. So we're being challenged to deliver, in ratings and on impressions. And I think for us, we have to move more to a direct-to-consumer company in a lot of different ways where data and understanding the consumer is super, super important. And for me, that's the concern. Congratulations to my friends at the NFL and all the associated sports networks for getting those deals done, because those are really, really hard. And, they're long-term deals. They're 11-year deals. We're blessed. We just finished March Madness. We have the relationship with the NBA. So we're sort of set. But I think we all have to figure out, as we work together, how do we keep the fan engaged? And really, more importantly, just give them a value exchange. You know, what is it that we can do for them as a customer, hyper-personalized, various interactive elements inside a broadcast, and just make it fun for them that they want to be engaged and spend time with us? You know, COVID did a lot of negative things, but I think for us as all evangelizers of technology that are on this call, it just advanced so many things, right? It just makes people comfortable with SRT and, remote broadcasts and just all the amazing technologies that came out of it. But it also enabled a lot of people to go look at other things and find other fandoms and interests that, are affecting sort of the traditional, sort of way that we tell stories and get people to participate. So long story short, that's for me what sort of is making me think. And then, how do I work really, really closely with Scott and the AT&T team to leverage all this amazing technology and good user data that we can provide these super hyper personalized experience to the consumer.
Right. And Scott. Yeah, Scott, I mean, those challenges that Pete just talked about, how are you guys on your side of things trying to confront those, as well as any other, huge challenges for the sports media and the media and entertainment industry overall?
Well, I mean, one of the biggest things is looking at the bandwidth that we keep running into at these venues, because now that everything's going for remote, things are just starting to explode. So how do we satisfy our customers who show up there who want that bandwidth and, want to be doing, a 30 channel Remy and being able to support that and be able to give our customers that type of experience? That's one huge thing for us, as well as the integration of all these other technologies, just, exactly what Pete was talking about.
Yeah, I mean, we saw the evolution of Remy go from, probably what was a 5-year model into what became like a 6-month model. Everything just exploded so fast. And obviously capacity and bandwidth has to keep up, right? And that's where you come in, where suddenly these venues and these media hubs are going to have to become huge pops, huge points of connectivity. So is that something that really is just in the last few months, everybody kind of coming to you and saying, okay, we need to figure out how to accommodate all these, Remy shows now?
Yeah. I mean, that's been the trend, but it really exploded. I mean, it's just, we just watched, one of the big things that we were doing for last year, working with one of those large leagues is, how do we have the ability to support all of our customers and talent being remote, set up a studio that's remote, set up where, normally it would just go right back to their headquarters, but now their headquarters is even I wouldn't say remote, but everything's out in the parking lot because they can't get in the building. So how do we satisfy that? We're shipping fly packs, ordering new bandwidth for these guys just to be able to support it. And in addition to that is, hey man, how do I take this and get it out over the internet? And how do I manage where my director might be in Malibu, California, but the master controls in Oklahoma, and another piece of it is in New York City, and how do I piece all this together? So that's been a real challenge, but it's been exciting because we've been able to pull off some really cool stuff. Just like Pete was saying, how do we integrate JPEG XS? How do we integrate SRT? How do you integrate the RIST? All of that.
Right.
And Jason, just to add to that, I think the key has also been the mentality and the shift for producers and directors that are in our business. I mean, and I know, I've worked with them for 25 years, and I think getting them comfortable to be technology literate and to feel safe that, my buddy Scott can provide really good, efficient bandwidth to make it feel like they're directing a show in their house, or that they feel like they can talk to their different operators. I think that was the huge shift. And I think we always wanted to push them, to be thinking about this. There are pressures in a lot of companies to see if you can figure out how to save money. And I think, this was a big move. And I think this just accelerated it. So it's really bravo to the ecosystem that on one mind share from a producer and a director and a content creator that we just adore because they tell great stories, they had to feel comfortable. And I think we were able to do that. And I think you'll see some return back to sort of what it was, but it won't be what it completely was. Like, I think there'll be an imprint about the technologies again that AT&T Global Services and other folks have been able to do that will make it more comfortable. And it will basically, I think, hopefully explode so many new opportunities and ideas where we can provide even, I said it earlier, just really hyper-personalized experiences for each consumer. And I think that part gets really exciting is how can we tell multiple stories about one particular game or one aspect of a contest. And I think that's exciting for me.
Yeah, absolutely. And, like you said, there will be some return to what the world was previously in terms of production workflows, but it's a, toothpaste back in the tube situation. There's no way that we'll go all the way back. It'll be a little bit of a hybrid, most likely. Mm-hmm. And that a lot of that is based on how successful some of the innovations over the last 12 months have been. Pete, I want to go back to you. Anything mm-hmm. specific that Warner Media is working on that you're excited about right now in terms of a specific project or maybe some of these next gen workflows that you think are going to enable those cool customized experiences for fans?
Yeah, I've been kind of, sort of beating the drum a little bit on WebRTC. I think, HLS, unbelievable technology. It's been around since my streaming career started in 2000, and it's been the ability for us to basically send content and distribute it really anywhere in the world on an internet connection. I think WebRTC has sort of blossomed in this time where we're using it right now, real-time communications to do, this Zoom talk. I think there's going to be an expectation from fans and from others to have a real-time experience. Like, why am I waiting 25 seconds, for to see the outcome of a game where I know in real time it's already happened and gone. And, we're working with companies in that space, Phoenix and others, where, we want to figure out how that technology can move itself. I think, again, I've been old enough where we saw HD completely be transformed with sports, right? Like, that drove the whole market. The whole ecosystem benefited from that, from the fans seeing an amazing, beautiful, video stream to, the manufacturers, the equipment providers, our bandwidth, et cetera, et cetera. So, for me, that's kind of up there right now. And then again, sort of what I said earlier is, how do I make people comfortable with user data? I think we've been in such a very sort of formidable position for so long that people had to come to us to watch content. And now there's just so many other wonderful distractions that people are into. So we just have to get better at that. So for me, that's kind of my two priorities right now.
Yeah. You mentioned, that there is concern over eyeballs right now, with mm-hmm. all the different choices and sports obviously, has been one that has struggled, but if we start looking at the personalization and what this has catalyzed and all those different feeds and the different presentations and that type of thing, I think we're entering a very cool new era potentially of sports presentation. And Scott, same thing on your side. Any specifically cool new projects or new things that you're working on with customers and within the AT&T family overall?
Yeah, I mean, I'd be remiss if we didn't bring up, the wireless side of the business. We're working on some really cool projects with, some really neat and one-off type deals where they're going to lead to bigger things. And I can't go too much into it, but I mean, with integration of wireless, fiber, satellite, and being able to go to some seriously remote locations where, being able to turn around a live broadcast out of that in great production quality, not just, not necessarily 5G, but any type of wireless solution. I mean, we've been very successful using AT&T wireless broadband and deploying those small little Cisco boxes out there. So those have been great. But this project that we're working on, this will be cool. This will be really cool. So stay tuned for that.
And then Jason, we both forgot, 5G is going to provide us, we'll be doing so much awesome experimentation. I don't know if you saw the, the sideline team camera that we use, we set up 5G in the network. And, every time we get out there and we test this, we test these scenarios. We had, cameras from Miley Cyrus concert. We've done stuff with Shaq. I just think it allows us to see more and more what we're able to do with 5G and just excited for those opportunities, on the low latency front, just quality of service, et cetera. So for me, that's been great being a WarnerMedia guy, going into a huge telco company and being able to work with guys like Scott and other people within the groups and saying, okay, what can we try? What can we get in a sandbox and then create that value exchange back to the consumer? It's been so much fun and just great, great, great people that are basically thinking about these things. So it's been, 5G is going to be something that we're all going to be hopefully, just slow and steady. We'll get there, but I think it's going to be transformational as well.
Yeah, it's cool to see those two things align because that's where you see the promise of 5G and what we're talking about with these multiple personalized experiences and, different viewpoints, potential 360 type stuff. Those align and suddenly you see, oh my God, this is really could be the way that I watch sports in the future. So speaking of the future and we've already discussed a little bit, but over the next year, what do you guys see coming down the pike? We are hopefully at a turning point a little bit when it comes to the pandemic and a little bit of return to normalcy and potentially, fans back in arenas and that type of thing. But from a sports media standpoint and a technology standpoint, how do you see the next 12 months coming out and what are maybe some very rough crystal ball predictions that you have? Pete, why don't we start with you and then Scott will close out with you.
Well, I mean, I think it's what happened with COVID. I remember 10 years ago getting in an Uber and having a pretty good conversation about streaming media with my driver. Like, what are you watching on, Netflix? And so the adoption of technology has really advanced a lot of expectations. So I think in the sports realm, it's not just going to be on the professional level. I think it's going to go all the way down to the youth level where there's going to be that expectation that wherever that game is being taken place, it's being streamed, it's being captured, it's being automated for highlights. And I think that expectation has sort of exploded, right? We're going to be able to leverage great technologies that we have here with AT&T and other third-party companies to sort of enable that on so many different levels. So what we once maybe, Jason, reserved for sort of pro sports or college sports, I think there's just going to be an expectation that you can bring that all the way down to the youth level. If your fourth grader is playing a volleyball game and you want to watch that game, why wouldn't you, right? The technology and the bandwidth and the expectation that it should be there, I think that's going to be the transformational because we've just moved it so quickly ahead during COVID that everybody is so much more digital literate, right? They know how to open a computer. They know how to open a phone. I think that's where I see a lot of the growth and opportunity to not only do this on the professional and collegiate level, but, basically in youth sports as well.
I'm excited to see my kid, playing youth soccer at home and maybe some 360 vision and all that kind of stuff. It's going to be great. Scott, how about you? What do you see coming down the pike over the next 12 months or so?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with Pete. I mean, and the different camera angles you can get just from the personalized uses of your 5G phone or even a 4G phone. I mean, you can get some incredible angles just by doing that. And if you look at using audience participation for camera angles, so can you pull those down and use those and put those into a live production? So I see that coming as well.
Great. Well, guys, we were all excited to see what could happen, you know, when the deal went down and what the technology from AT&T and the production and creativity from Warner Media could do. And we're starting to see that really, really come to life. So I'm sure the next 12 months will be exciting. And we'll check in again then and hopefully see some of these things you guys are teasing. But for now, Pete, Scott, thank you guys so much for taking the time, and stay well out there. Okay.
Okay.